Hello everybody on YouTube, welcome at the Battle of Topsus. No armies yet. First I'm going to explain you more or less what the situation is. Julius Caesar has started the first real Roman civil war. He had to fight Pompey, defeats Pompey in Greece, Pompey flees to Egypt, gets killed. Julius Caesar goes to Egypt and settles some things there. However, Julius Caesar also takes the opportunity to have some sort of big holiday, which takes some months. He's away from Rome. There's a rebellion in Pontus. Some descendant of Mithridates is trying again to get some power. But in the meantime, also the Republican forces, who were defeated, of course, when Pompey was general, the remnants, they flee to Africa, to modern-day Tunisia also. And they assemble a new army, but they have plenty of time since Julius Caesar is of course enjoying Cleopatra and is enjoying the Nile and all the beautiful things that Egypt has to offer. So, now, Julius Caesar of course is recalled back, defeats the uprising in Pontus and heads back to Rome, and then he assembles an army to fight off the last Republican armies in Africa. Now, Julius Caesar is, here we have the little city of Topsus. You have to imagine this is water, this is water, this is land, this is water. And what we have here is a giant swampy lake. Now, Julius Caesar is trying to besiege this city, so he has a line of fortifications and is trying to starve out the city. Messengers are sent to the other Republican armies, and the Republican armies come from this direction. And they are led by Scipio, who is Pompey's father-in-law. Well, Pompey's dead at the moment, so no more father-in-law. And he's aided by King Juba of Mauritania. King Juba has a personal thing with Julius Caesar, because years before they had been in an argument, and Julius Caesar grabbed the king by his beard. So, of course, a big thing to settle. Now, Julius Caesar, of course, is here with his army, and he realizes that the opponents are coming over here. So he has a fort constructed over here to make sure that these armies cannot pass through. So you always have soldiers that can come out and attack a column. Now, like I said, we have Scipio here, we have Juba here. And Scipio takes his army and goes round the lake and ends up here. Juba is staying here with some of his soldiers, and in the next phase I'm going to tell you how the battle evolved. Now, here we have phase two of the battle, a small close-up. I've looked it of course up in the books and on the internet. It's not really clear. The deployments are roughly clear, so this again is a nutshell version of what happened that day. Here we have the fort blocking Juba. Here we have the Topsus, the city of Topsus being besieged. We probably here have Caesar's camp. I didn't put it here, but it's probably over here. Here we have Scipio's camp. Now, like I said, this is water. And Julius Caesar has a subordinate called Crispus. And he told Crispus to sail with a fleet along the shoreline. And they had to make a lot of noise. They had to pretend that they were probably going for an invasion from this side or from the back, so this is some sort of decoy. Now, both armies have about between 40 and 50,000 soldiers. Caesar's force is probably a bit smaller, but in size they were almost equal. So here we have Caesar's army, Scipio's army. Here we have elephants intermingled with skirmishers, and on both sides of course we also have cavalry. These are Caesar's skirmishers, and Caesar, like Pharsalus, deployed a fourth line behind his cavalry because of the elephant attack. I don't know if I've said it before, but Juba gave 60 war elephants, so they're placed here. Now, because of this movement, Scipio's forces are a bit in, not really in a panic, but they don't know what to do, so they assemble their army and they go back into the camp, and it's a kind of a mess. Julius Caesar here is waiting for the attack. He's not sure whether to attack or not, but it takes quite some time, and on the right wing they become a bit impatient, and what you can imagine is that soldiers in this part of the army are trying to seduce the trumpeter to launch the signal. The trumpeter refuses, but of course after more approaches he all of a sudden he signals the attack. Julius Caesar has no idea, so he hears all of a sudden from here the signal for the attack. The signal is picked up by the entire army and they move a rapid advance. But because of this rapid advance, the front soldiers and the skirmishers, they launch a ferocious attack on the elephants. And especially on the right side, the side that started, it was very, very successful because the elephants all of a sudden trample into their own lines, trample into their own cavalry, and Julius Caesar's forces can actually attack very rapidly, and the entire army is already, yeah, within seconds, is on the run, being of course pursued. And like I said, Scipio had like 40,000 soldiers and 25,000 end up dead. At the end of the battle there were like 10,000 soldiers that wanted to surrender, but this time there was no surrender for Julius Caesar, so Julius Caesar had them all killed. Yeah, it's a very short battle and I claim this to be the fastest battle ever. I think it's even faster than Gagamela or the battle at Issus, but it doesn't really matter. It was a quick victory. After this battle, Scipio flees to Juba. Scipio flees some other place and gets defeated at sea, so he dies, and Juba commits suicide. Well, commits suicide, he is a duel to the death with another Roman. He wins this and then he kills himself. So is the civil war over? No, because Caesar goes back to Italy and again Republican forces are waiting for him at in Spain. And there we have the finishing battle, the battle at Munda. So, one of the quickest battles in history, the battle at Topsus. Yeah, I hope you enjoyed it and thank you very much for listening.